Crossrail, largest infrastructure project in Europe. I had the privilege to be part of the team delivering the project for the past 4.5 years, and I'm currently leading the technical and quality aspects of Farringdon Station. You probably have heard a lot about Crossrail over the past years, so I'm going to give you a quick brief about what the project is and where we are at the moment. But what I'm going to mostly focus on is what we're doing to basically make use of the scale, the size, the challenge to create an impact and leave a legacy, hopefully well over the project finishes. And I think we're finishing with some Q&A afterwards. Before we start, though, a bit about me, just for some context as to why I am talking about Crossrail. I'm Lebanese by origin. I grew up in a small city in Lebanon. I was privileged enough to go to the American University of Beirut. I studied electrical and computer engineering there. And after graduating, I joined Bechtel here in the UK. And if you know, Bechtel is the largest construction and engineering company in the US. And we have a lot of contracts here in the UK. One of them is Crossrail, where we're the delivery partner and basically working alongside Crossrail to the client to deliver this fantastic project. As part of Bechtel, I've worked on major railway projects here in the UK, and from the start to finish, from the design section till the delivery and testing and commissioning phase. And I've also worked in, with a few of my colleagues to initiate Women at Bechtel. It's a networking forum for both men and women to basically share experiences and share tools for success. I also worked on Bechtel Stewardship program, led it in the UK, the Middle East, and Africa for a bit over a year. But my career highlight so far has definitely been my current role on Farringdon Station. I mean, it's absolutely fantastic, all the work that's happening. And for somebody like me who's never set foot on a train before coming to the UK, being part of such a massive project is an absolute privilege. So I'm quite happy to be there. So Crossrail, 14.8 billion, connecting Reading in the west to Shenfield and Abbey Wood in the east. Running through 42 kilometers of brand new tunnels underneath London and southeast London. And it's the first time that Heathrow has been is now connected with the middle of the city, with the business center, and with Oxford Street. Obviously, a journey that currently takes around more than an hour will be shortened to way less than 24 minutes. So it will bring people way closer to London. It will bring 1.5 million people within 45 minutes of central London. People will have access to the city, and it's absolutely amazing. 24 trains will run in both directions every hour, so that's around 200 million journeys a year, and it will increase the capacity by 10% instantly the minute it operates. And this has not happened since World War II. This is how much the capacity is going to increase, so it's absolutely fantastic. Just to give you an idea about the scale of Crossrail, this is what a typical station looks like. People would have, so the teams, we would have basically created two massive shafts, 30 meters to 40 meters deep, and then these are connected within by the platforms, and the platforms have been created by running tunnels, and then eventually enlarged to create the platform where everybody will hopefully be standing in a year's time. And I think it's absolutely fascinating that the amount, of the, with the scale, we had to acquire quite a lot of land and the property around the stations just to be able to build them. And people will only be able to see around 10 to 15% of these stations. And the majority of it is actually back of house areas and just where we will house just to run the stations for its operations, staffing areas, and everything else afterwards. And if you see how close we are from the other operational railways, I think the record on Crossrail was coming around 80 centimeters away from the Jubilee line. So that's as high as a tennis racket, basically. And this is how accurate tunneling was, and this is how challenging it is to do a project in the middle of the City of London or in the middle of an urban environment. And this gives you an idea about the scale. There will be, for every one of the stations, a western ticket hall, an eastern ticket hall, connected by 260 meters long platforms. So you really need to know which end of the platform you need to get out at. Otherwise, it's going to be a really long walk. As I said, then connected by escalator barrels and then the cross passages in between. The funding model. Crossrail has been funded jointly by Transport for London and Department for Transport. It's a joint sponsorship program. And a lot of it, I think the key differentiator is the private sector funding as well. And I think this is one of the key lessons learned from previous railway projects in the UK, where the airspace above the stations was not really invested. But this has been changed around on Crossrail. All the stations will have between 7 to 8 stories of oversight development, and this will house retail units and shopping areas, business units, residential units, and it will bring a much needed stream of revenue to the project. We're still within the £14.8 billion pounds of funding envelope, and we're working to that. And it's just the difference when the Crossrail idea first started in the early 19th century, it was described as imaginative, basically. And the cost of it was estimated at £300 million. That wouldn't buy us basically half a station at this time. So fast forward 65 years, it's that much money, and it's great that we're still within that funding envelope after, especially because of the duration of the project. I think it's a great achievement to the team to do that. Property impacts, I think it's important to mention that because we do understand that the impact that Crossrail has extends way beyond the scale of the structures that we are building ourselves. So Crossrail commissioned a private company to say how much, to do an estimate on how much the impact was on properties. We paid around £800 million to purchase land and property so that we can build the stations and build the project. But also, the assessment came up to £13 billion. This transformed from £5 billion when Crossrail first started. And it's basically a massive impact on the property, not only the current property, but also unleashing potential in areas where there were no stations before, and now there is stations and there is investment going forward. But also, I think it's quite important to mention that the opportunities extend way beyond London. It is all about London, moving London forward, but also when you talk about Crossrail itself, the business opportunities extended way beyond. More than 60% of the contracts were let to companies outside London. And around 60% of those were to small and medium-sized businesses. So I think the impact has been felt across the country from the London project. And just from a personal experience, on a day-to-day, we reach out to all areas to get a specialized task force for very specific tasks that we need on the project, and we're not able to find that in the UK. So obviously, the impact has been felt across. So where are we now? 90% complete, so only 10% to go. And we're just getting ready to energize by the end of the year and start our dynamic testing, trialing. And the major focus is now to test the systems, commissioning, finishing, and bringing the infrastructure maintainer on board, doing the training maintenance, and bringing everybody on board to just basically start handing over the railway and make it operational. So that's the really key focus. And then the stage opening has started in 2017 and it will continue until May 2018 when the whole section will be running and operational. In terms of stations, I'll just spend some time talking about that. So you see the pictures in terms of the with the massive key, and this symbolized handing over a section of the station to the system, basically from the station teams to what we refer to as system-wide contractors. And this symbolized a massive point in time, because this is when station teams were ready, and they were ready for what we refer to as the railway systems contractors, basically, to take over some areas within the station and start installing their kit, basically, to transform it from a civil project into an operational railway, basically. You see the glass fiber reinforced concrete is there and installed, and this is the signature architectural feature of Crossrail. So you will know when the minute you go into a station that this is a Crossrail station. And also all the other architectural features that are very unique and specific to each station to take into consideration the historical area around it is also all there and installed. Most of it is there and installed now. Also, escalators are in, and the platform screen doors, so very similar to what you now have on the Jubilee line, just a full-height platform screen door is now there and installed as well. In terms of system-wide, and this is what I was referring to as the railway systems who will transform basically the station, the railway to becoming an operational railway. So this is all the communication systems, the signaling, the overhead line, the power, and everything that comes with it. They are also well underway. Ready to energize by the end of the year. We have the massive tunnel ventilation system all installed and ready to be commissioned. Each one of these fans is more than 10 tons, weighs more than 10 tons. So there's a massive, massive workload there to be done. And the track system is all laid, 52 kilometers of it, all laid in, on different slabs, concrete slabs or different slabs, depending on the area, is also all there. So and the teams are really quite ready. So the trains, that's what most of us will see, hopefully, in a couple of months' time. These are the new Elizabeth Line trains, brand new. 66 of them, all opened, similar to what you have now on the Metropolitan line, air-conditioned, really state-of-the-art in terms of some of the functionality, and they have been built with the comfort of passengers in mind. And basically, these trains will be 200 meters long trains, but if you noticed, our platforms were 260 meters long, in some stations slightly longer, so this is to allow for future-proofing and basically increasing capacity in the future. And MTR, a Hong Kong company, Mass Transit Rail, won the contract to operate the railway for the first 8 years, and then it has an option for 2 years renewal after that. And this is it, bringing it into service. So it's a staged operation, staged bringing into service. The first section in the blue line you see there is already operational, and then the second section, which is the central section, it will become operational in December 2018, and the full thing from start to finish operational in May 2019. So that's basically a brief about Crossrail overall. But this is what I really wanted to focus on today. How are we? We spoke a lot about the what, but now about the how. And I picked a couple of stories, which I would like to share with you today, as to how I truly believe we made a difference and we created an impact. And we will be moving the whole industry forward with us with these steps that we took. So I chose a couple of ones. One, a courageous leadership in safety, how we created a really proud quality culture, how we look after our neighbors in terms of community involvement and all our community investment, and how Crossrail is changing the image of construction. And I'm just going to go through each one after that. So health and safety, I think it's absolutely fascinating that we spent so far around 200 million hours on the project. And I truly believe, just working there day in, day out, that the culture we created in terms of health and safety and just embedding health and safety in everything we do day in, day out is absolutely phenomenal. And this is what the whole construction industry is doing that at the moment. Our safety records improved phenomenally over the years. But what Crossrail, I think, did particularly well is focusing on the behavioral element and really talking about people's behaviors and the way people have their approach to health and safety and the way this would make a massive impact on the work that we do. Another key element, which I think is quite important, is us looking at leading indicators instead of measuring contractors after the event happens. And with that, I mean really looking at health and safety performance indices that will push people to think about, okay, we have this activity coming up. What are we going to do so that we don't have harm happen in the first place? And actually have some metrics in place to be able to measure that. I think this is quite a differentiator, and it's shifted the way people think about health and safety, and shifted, just created this proactive approach, really. One that I particularly like is the health and safety around heavy goods vehicles. We obviously all live in, most of us live in London. We know how crowded the streets are. I'm gonna go back. We know how crowded the streets are, and we know how important this is for all of us. Probably a lot of us use their bikes, and we all walk on the streets. And I think this is quite important because of the scale and because of how many lorries and how many lorry movements we have as Crossrail. I'll just tell you a story. In 2009, when construction started, the teams spent a lot of time just to get started. They just wanted to get there. We had tons of excavated material ready to be moved. We had material ready to be shipped to site. And everybody worked quite hard just forming these teams and getting them all engaged and just wanting to start. And in a lot of projects, all of it just stopped. Just stopped, basically. And Ailey McAdam, a Bechtel SVP who was looking after the project at the time, she issued an instruction to every single project manager on the program to say not to receive any lorry on site if it doesn't comply 100% of the safety standards that we've set out. And these standards were always in the contract. It wasn't something new, but people were not really complying with them. And I must admit, a lot of the people on site thought that this was an absolutely crazy decision, that the whole project is just going to stop. Nobody's going to do it. No one is going to fit every single lorry, the thousands of them, with these safety features. And these are around 20 additional safety things that needed to be installed in every single lorry to alert them to the presence of pedestrians or cyclists on the road. So everybody thought no one is going to do it. But actually, it needed this courageous leadership, and it needed somebody to just make a decision and understand the impact, understand the scale of the responsibility, and just basically push it. And the whole industry stepped up. We have all the Crossrail lorries, even until now, if something is not compliant, it's not accepted on site. And basically, I'm on the receiving end as well, so especially if you've been waiting for a long lead item for such a long time to turn up on site and not actually just on your doorstep and not get it in, it's quite frustrating. But I think we've done a massive advancement in the industry in that, and I think it's absolutely fantastic that these rules are now part of Tideway. So TAMS Tideway have this enforced on their contracts. HS2 will have these enforced on their contracts, and I think this will be the future of the industry going forward. So that was the first element, the safety element of it. And then to the quality element of it. Obviously, with my role as the engineering manager and the project field engineer on the station, pushing my team to produce a quality product is what I do day in, day out. And I truly believe, just with working with these teams, the culture that we created is none I've seen before in my career. And this is because you're working with people who really want to get it right and are passionate about it and want to do their best to get it right and to come up with these new ideas. But I think importantly, they are not afraid about learning from their mistakes when something goes wrong. The key differentiator, I think, that we did is moving quality from being a sort of side function, supportive function, to being a responsibility of the engineers themselves. So making the engineers themselves responsible for what they are delivering, responsible for producing the right documentation for the product that they are delivering, getting the right tests in place, getting the right certification in place, and them being accountable for it as part of their day-to-day work. And I think we worked quite hard to make sure that this is cascaded all the way down to the supply chain, which I think is also quite important. So every single point in time on the project, we have around 30 to 40 different contracts. And these are from very, very small contracts, very small companies, to major, huge companies working, delivering massive scale product. And to be able to bring everybody on board and then brief them, I carried lots of supplier briefings, just briefing them about what the expectation is, what do we want to achieve, what are we actually trying to do, I think took a huge effort. And I truly believe that with each one of these companies who played a role on Crossrail, just through this process, everybody got upscaled, and when they start working on the future project, it's just going to start from this higher bar, basically. And I'll just be throughout the talk referring to quite a lot on Farringdon, but just because I work on Farringdon Station, but this is definitely true on every single project across, and I know my colleagues do exactly the same. The other element of it is innovation. I think the industry, the construction industry overall, is just running slightly behind the curve in innovation, especially if you compare it to manufacturing or to other industries. We're lacking quite a lot, I think, in terms of investment in technology and in planning, and we're stalling slightly behind. And I think productivity is also one of the key areas that is just holding our industry back overall. And this is why I think what what we're doing day in, day out is quite important. So this is just an example. This is Farringdon Station again. We are the only station to cast our secondary lining versus spraying it. So secondary lining, this is the lining tunnel, and then you have the primary lining to just create the shape, and then the secondary lining, which is an inner layer, and between them they take the load of the earth, basically the load overall. And the industry practice is spraying so far, and most of the stations on Crossrail are sprayed. It has its huge benefits, but we have on Farringdon, our platforms, as I mentioned, they are the longest with 300 million pounds. Sorry, 300 meters long. So, excuse me, 300 meters long. And they basically, we just made it as an excuse to just create something new, I think. The teams went to Kern, the company who created this Kern shutter, basically. And they came up with this solution to create a massive, a huge shutter, which follows the line of the tunnel to pour the secondary lining instead of spraying it. And by following this method, we were able to save an extra around 8,000 meter cubes of concrete overall. So we would have spent 8,000 meter cubes of concrete if we did not follow this method. And just somebody did the analysis, and this is the equivalent of going to the moon and back 5 times. This is how huge that was. And I think also, just going back to my previous point about heavy goods vehicle and transport, I think this saved us a whole load of lorry movements coming to site. It saved a lot of pollution in the tunnels themselves. I'm not, if you have an experience of being in a tunnel while it's being sprayed, we did quite a lot of work to improve air quality, but air quality is not great when you're just in the middle of spraying. So that got improved massively. The quality of the end product was absolutely fantastic. You can see in there, it really didn't need any cladding above it. It just looks absolutely fantastic. In terms of productivity as well, when we first started, we didn't really achieve the productivity we hoped we would achieve. So we were only able to do around 1.5 pours, but we did a Six Sigma analysis and we were able to increase that to 6 pours per week, 4 to 6 pours a week. And this improvement, I think it also, this method showed that, especially showed people who were a bit suspicious about using it in the first place, that coming up with an innovative way, with a new way to do something, not the typical way of doing it, and a bit different from what everybody else is doing, it not only gave us an amazing product at the end, but it saved us time, it saved cost, it massively improved our health and safety indices. And it also left something amazing to the whole tunneling industry to learn from. This won several accolades in the tunneling industry, and it just gave people an idea about how tunneling can be done, basically, going forward. And it was so successful that we thought, why not? We'll do it on an incline as well. And it was the first time this method has been used. It was a really awkward shape, very complicated planning required. It's a 30 degrees incline, that escalator barrel. So trying to keep the concrete in one place and trying to keep the pour in one place was an amazing challenge. And the health and safety also arrangements around that, every single person working on that had to be very specifically trained to be able to work on this piece of work. But it's just an example as to how we moved the whole industry forward, specifically the construction industry. Technically, we moved it along in the right direction. Learning legacy. The other example is non-conformances or quality defects, as everybody working would know them. And I've worked on several projects before, and these tend to be just normally swept under the carpet, usually. They are not very well publicized and definitely not shared. And I think we turned this concept around, and we provided some commercial incentive to be able to do that. But I think critically, we were able to get people to notify, basically, when something goes wrong. Because we really wanted to share it across all sites, it wasn't any good for somebody to make a mistake and then get it repeated in all stations across the line. And with that, we had we have a lot of non-conformances. In fact, 18,000 of them. You would think it's an absolutely huge number. When you think about the scale, the complexity, and everything in terms of documentation, in terms of processes, there is a lot that we can go wrong, and which sometimes did go wrong. But more importantly, I think just we created it, we moved it into what we're calling a learning legacy. So this is basically a massive database where all this information should be then eventually collated and put online for everybody to use, for all the future projects to use. And I think we just by collating this information, it's an absolute wealth of information for people to be able to use as they start the future major project and the future major mega project. And we've had visitors not only from the UK, but also from across the globe, from Brazil, from Sydney, from the US, and all of them, we will be, and this is the importance of that, is that it can be shared with everybody. And we just next time we're starting from that bar, from just a slightly higher bar than what we usually have. And lastly, in terms of that, just the quality, I think this is also a very key differentiator, which is the performance of contractors. I think we definitely worked quite hard to make sure that everybody is performing to the right standard. But Crossrail had, their main logo is a world-class railway. And in practice, when you come to actually doing it, there is this massive gap between being a world-class railway and what you're actually paying people to do. And the contractual obligations is what you see on the red line. And we were thinking, okay, how do we actually move everybody to put this discretionary effort and want to perform as a world-class organization rather than just stick to their contractual obligations and deliver a program at the end, deliver a station? Definitely took a lot of hard work. This wasn't something that it was easy to do. But we created some form of a healthy competition between contracts. And as I said, the culture that we built really drove people to think about, okay, how am I going to improve my processes? How am I going to improve my productivity? How am I going to improve the quality of the product I deliver at the end? How am I going to make sure that we're not here sat, all of us, 3 years after Crossrail, trying to collate all the documents and trying to give assurance to the infrastructure maintainer afterwards to say, yeah, it's okay and it's safe to operate? And we drove this culture of competition because nobody wanted to be the really rubbish performer at the bottom corner. And people were coming up with great ideas and with progressive assurance, with really ways to streamline processes and improve productivity. And when we started this process, we started by people being just meeting their contractual obligations and not really just around that line. And if you see around the years, everybody just moved up. And I truly believe that after that, when people are starting a new project, no one is going to start from where they started a couple of years ago on Crossrail. I think everybody is gonna just take that bar as a standard for their organization and really start from there going forward in the future. So just in terms of quality, I think we still as an industry have a lot to go. I think we're nowhere near where we need to be in terms of, as I said, investment in technology or investment or improving our productivity. There is definitely quite a lot of lean ways we can do our work. I think I feel really proud to be able to just contribute to moving it in the right direction and just moving this curve closer to where it needs to be. I think we created a wealth of information which will be a massive learning legacy and will truly transform our industry just for future projects in the UK or across the globe. Neighbours, next. This is Whitechapel Station. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the site. I think if I was working there, it would be an absolute challenge, to say the least. These guys interface with a very, very busy shopping area. They have a massive market in front of the station, if you're familiar with the area. And it's in the center of the community and of the way people operate. They have flats, just people looking basically over the site. They have schools, hospitals, roads. It's an absolute nightmare of a place, to be honest, but to be building a project. And to be able to build a project in there, and it makes it, I think, the most challenging and the most complex logistically, just the most challenging across the whole program. And these guys, we have to build basically a new station over two, not one, operational railways. And it makes it an absolute, it's just credit to the team working there on how much work is needed to do that. And to be able to do this work, I think, is absolutely impossible. To complete it, to do it on time, to do it on budget, without a massive involvement from everybody around you. I think the team puts an enormous amount of effort to make sure that everybody all the work is communicated. It's communicated early to people. Their thoughts and their concerns are answered, and they're taken seriously. And people, they've put some things in place like noise and vibration monitoring. They offer rehousing. They just go this extra length is just to make sure that this is, I think, to make sure that the work is happening and that everybody around them is happy and happy for Crossrail to be part of this community, I think. Our project director refers to this as our license to operate, and I truly believe that you need to build invest in this community so that it's able to give you back, and when you're stuck and you need help, that you're able to get that help. This is one of the pictures or the artist impressions, they call it, of a weekend possession. One of the weekend possessions, and it has basically the cranes that are operating during that time, and you could see how challenging that is. And during one of these weekend possessions, the team had to install the railway, the ticket hall, basically, which spans above the site. This ticket hall will be housed inside a 180 meters long bridge. And the frame for that ticket hall has more than 7,000 different pieces. And it's like a massive puzzle, basically. So these guys have fun. And obviously, because it's above operational railway, you cannot just build it just like you do it on a greenfield project. You have to plan it, and you build it during railway possessions. So this is when the London Underground and the other railway is not running through Whitechapel, or trains are not stopping in Whitechapel. And this is not a long time. This is usually either weekdays and during the night, or weekend possessions, or major Christmas blockades or Easter blockades. So these possessions have to be planned to the absolute detail. And if something goes wrong, well, tough, wait till tomorrow. Or if a Christmas goes wrong, well, yeah, wait till Christmas next year to deliver it. So it's not. It takes a lot of planning and a lot of work to get these things right. So with these 7,000 different pieces of steel, what the team did in that occasion, they planned every single one of these members, where it is going to be placed on the delivery wagon, which is coming from Holland, how it is going to be oriented on the wagon, so that when it gets to Whitechapel, it is in exactly the right place, so that we can remove it and put it in place in the most efficient way possible and using the least tonnage possible, so that we don't need massive cranes and we don't need massive, which results in less noise and less vibration, so we don't disrupt everybody around us. And I think it is this commitment and this level of planning and this level of detail which makes Crossrail and the teams working there so special in terms of how they really take the community and everybody around them so seriously, and they truly believe that it is fundamental to the success of their project. And I think going forward for projects going forward, when you think about Crossrail, I think it's absolutely fascinating that just with this example, multiply it across the city. And it's, to me personally, fascinating that we, with this study, when they measured press relations with favorability of organizations, Crossrail scored way up. And it takes this dedication and this commitment to be able to achieve that. And I truly think that with that, it's definitely moving the industry forward with the expectation of what people expect when you're talking about mega projects and dense urban environments. This is what people will be expecting. And this brings me to women in engineering and changing the image of construction. Excuse me. This is a topic that absolutely fascinates me. It's something I'm extremely passionate about. It's probably normal. I'm a woman engineer working on site. This is just going back a few years when I was studying in the American University of Beirut. And when I was the only girls in a lab, in a science lab, or in a robotics lab, or whatever. I think I didn't see it as odd, not at all, not at the slightest. And it's quite a lot of women in the class. We had quite a lot of women in our engineering class. We were about 20% of women, so it was just a good percentage overall. But I was quite surprised when I came to the UK that the percentages were not better, and as a matter of fact, they were a bit worse. Than that, and basically in the UK, I think only 15% of women are engineers, and of engineering students are engineers, and when you move it to the workforce, only 9% are of engineering women working in the construction industry are women. And then when you move it to operatives and to manual workforce, then it's only 2%. So there is just it's a very, very small percentage. I do quite a lot of talks in schools and talking to students and kind of what are you going to study? And we have quite a lot of girls coming into our site, and what are you going to study? And even people who are on our site, who are theoretically really interested in engineering, really interested in construction, when you ask these young, and they are absolutely amazing, young, talented women, what are you going to study? It's literature and, best case, math. And basically, the A-level physics women or girls, students studying physics, are only 20%. And this trend basically is not improving. This has not changed in the past 20, 25 years. So there is definitely a need for something to be done. And I'm not going to talk about the benefits of diversity and the benefits of bringing women into the industry. I think people are quite up to speed with the benefit this brings. But I think, especially in the UK, with all the amount of investment that is happening in infrastructure and all the commitment to infrastructure, I think this is it's quite fundamental that a change needs to happen. And it seems like women are able to make use of the infrastructure, but they are not able to contribute to build it, or are not at the moment building it. And if I spend some time just thinking about that, and then kind of just thinking about kind of what and asking people who come to sites, why is that the case? And I just think that especially with the current modern projects, mega projects that we work on, you have complex projects, complex challenges to face. You have these projects require meticulous planning. They require really focusing on the detail. They require community investment. They require client interface. And these are all skills that women have in bucket loads. So there is no reason for us not to have enough. And I think this is why what we're doing on Crossrail is extremely important. And I think when you bring women in, they instigate their own change. This picture is real, by the way. I mention it because a journalist once told me that she thought it was staged, but it actually isn't. This is me on the left, Nisreen Shartouni, who's an absolutely inspiring, fantastic project manager. She's there in the middle. And Patricia Sanchez, who's an amazing civil engineer, on the right. And when I ordered my PPE, I needed size 4 boots, and I had to wait 4.5 weeks for them. They were the longer lead item than chillers. This is how long it took me to get them. And fast forward only a few years, we now have female PPE, and and the smallest size even we have. And also I think this is why I think when you have more people, they instigate their own change. Linda Miller, who's another Bechtel project manager, who just yesterday actually received her OBE for all the work that she's done and all the inspiring work that she's done and her contributions to engineering and construction. When she was project manager on Farringdon, she banned the use of what she called discriminatory language, which is everything that relates to man hours, man riders, and anything to that sort. You're not allowed to use that. And this is basically because it's a small change. It's not going to make a massive, it's not going to truly transform whether women would come into the industry or not. But these are the small changes that will make, I think, a lot of impact, because it will make it an inclusive environment, and it will make it an environment where everybody's welcome, that it's not a man's world, and where women have as much to contribute as anybody else. The other thing that I think we did extremely well is outreach. And we, alongside with Crossrail, have Young Crossrail. Bechtel has Women at Bechtel. And through the stewardship efforts, through the community involvement effort, we partnered with a lot of organizations who share the same goal. So we basically partnered with women in construction, we partnered with women in engineering, in science and engineering. We implemented a lot of their tools so that we focus on, one, bringing young girls in to just tell them about what construction is, what engineering is, encourage them to take up STEM subjects, to take up tools to support with women retention, basically, after they join the project, how we keep them in and how we make sure they are welcome and okay to stay on the project. But also just opening up opportunities for shadowing and for young students to come in, spend their week or two, spend their week just shadowing different engineers, shadowing different people. And I must say, this is not only for women, but making sure that we are an open project who welcomes people and who's willing to encourage people, basically, to come in and learn how exciting and how amazing that environment is. And I've personally had several letters from people thanking us on the opportunity and just telling us how massive of an impact that this has made to them. This has definitely made a massive impact. I think with Crossrail in general had done an amazing job with their apprenticeship program and making sure that 27% of those apprentices are women or people from an absolute diverse background. And for us working in London and in the UK, I think we all appreciate how important that is. And I think this is much needed to make a change and make an impact going forward. And I truly believe that with all the work that Crossrail has done and definitely resonates with what the Royal Institute do in terms of just supporting educators and supporting people to encourage their young children to come and study some subjects. So I think we have definitely moved the industry forward as to what the expectations are. And changing the image, I think, is a massive message. I spend a lot of time with students in schools, and when I tell them, do you know what we do? And the answers vary. It's nowhere near actually what it is. And I think it's quite important for this image to change, for people to feel encouraged that this is something that they can take up and that it is an opportunity for them just like anybody else across. And this is why I think what we did on Crossrail really moved the bar and really is changing the industry going forward. So with that, I think... overall, I think we did quite a lot of work. We definitely worked on a learning legacy. We changed the culture, the quality culture. We've put some metrics in place in health and safety to change the focus and change the behavior and change the way people think about health and safety. We innovated. We definitely pushed the bar slightly higher. And I truly believe and I feel really proud to be part of a project where I think next time when we start on a project, we're just starting from this place, this slightly higher place than what everybody else is currently used to in the industry. And I think we worked all together extremely well along with the Crossrail values, collaboratively between client and contractor, with a client who's so focused about the how and how we're delivering it and the importance on how you deliver a project compared to what you're delivering. And I really think that Crossrail is not only changing the industry in terms of just moving London forward, it's truly changing the economy. It's truly changing lives with bringing more people into the industry and really, really pushing the bar and moving the industry forward. So with that, thank you very much.